Well, I'd like to welcome everyone to the CIR seminar, which is a report-back seminar by Lyndon H. LaRouche. Mr. LaRouche and his wife, Helga Zepp LaRouche, were in Moscow at the end of April. They were there at the invitation of the Universal Ecological Academy. Mr. LaRouche had become a full member of this academy on March 17th. While he was there, he spoke to the Ministry of Economics of the Russian Federation. He also spoke to the Russian Academy of Sciences, specifically the Africa Institute, the Institute of Oriental Studies, and the Institute of Scientific Information on Social Sciences. While Mr. LaRouche was there, he had the opportunity to present to the participants in these seminars his European Triangle proposal, his economic policies, and the prospect for dealing with the upcoming impending economic crash. There were many discussions back and forth. I'd like you all to welcome Mr. LaRouche, and he will give us a report on the various discussions that took place. Thank you.
Thank you. I passed out. It got here late, and I apologize for a couple of minor typos in it. But I passed out something that serves the purpose of a glossary, which may be relevant to questions or any follow-up on this standpoint of knowing what physical economy is. It's a term that tends to confuse people. So I supplied this for that purpose. Now, it's well known that by now that I had the trip to Moscow. We spent, in a period of 6 days, 4 days in meetings, which ranged from the Ministry of Economics, which sponsored an event at which I spoke, which was attended by ministry people and otherwise largely by people from the Ecological Academy or the Natural Sciences Division of the Academy of Sciences. There were a number of other meetings over the following day, Tuesday. There were meetings on Wednesday with the Africa and Oriental Institutes, which was interesting. And there was on Thursday, there were some very significant meetings with the INION. And then later in the day, evening, a very important meeting with Suslov, the son of the famous Mikhail Suslov, and with Pobisk, Georgievich Kuznetsov, a famous Russian space biology scientist. One of the most important factors in this, I just mentioned now, is that an interesting process has been going on, which relates very much to this visit. The background to the visit were some since particularly the events of mid-1991. A number of my associates had been in Russia, then in the former Soviet Union, then Russia, as well as in Ukraine. And in these countries in Eastern Europe, they found that I was well known, which is not entirely surprising, that from the spring of 1983 into beyond 1987, the official Soviet press had damned me frequently and prominently in a way which is incomparable in modern history, at least post-war history. So that I was very well known in Moscow, and I was known in Moscow as the author of the SDI. And the reason that was so in Moscow, particularly among the backgrounders, is that Moscow had first learned of what became known as the SDI through my background discussions of over a year preceding Reagan's announcement, in which I had conducted the exploratory discussions on SDI, which had been my design, which had been, in the course of events, adopted as a project by the Reagan administration. And then President Reagan himself, despite George Bush and James Baker III, had actually adopted the policy and promulgated it. What was promulgated by the president, for example, on the 23rd of March, 1983, was exactly what I had indicated the president might propose to the Russians or to the Soviet government in previous discussions. The reason it occurred that way is because the Reagan White House, or the people involved, wished to make it clear to Moscow that my exploratory discussions with them on this project were being adopted in essentially by the president. So these two factors, the fact that I had become international public enemy number one, had been called a singly, individually, a casus belli in 1983 officially by the Soviet government, had been referred to as a casus belli, as an individual, by Soviet representatives in a number of countries, including in London. These were his semi-private official discussions, and had been called everything in the book. And as a matter of fact, in 1984, as some of you recall, the Soviet press, supported by Senator Moynihan, demanded that the Reagan administration break off all contact with me as a gesture of good faith with Moscow, and things like that. Then in 1986, the Soviet press officially and repeatedly had demanded that I be incarcerated by the Reagan administration as a token of good faith for summit negotiations. So those were the things that tended to interest witting people, shall we say, in Russia about me. My wife subsequently made trips to Russia. In the course of these things, some people in Russia became very interested in my writings and publishing them in Russian. A similar process occurred in Ukraine. As a result of this process, a book was translated, my 1986 textbook, which is really an introductory textbook to applied physical economy, was translated into Russian. And prior to its publication, some of this was circulated in Russian as well as in Ukraine. It was a parallel project. And in the course of this, a number of people became very interested in what we had to say, especially this professor, Pobisk Georgievich Kuznetsov, who was a very famous figure in Russian post-war history. Now, Mr. Kuznetsov had a very interesting reaction to this, which is quite relevant to my getting to Moscow. The reaction was that everything I said in this book, he knew to be true. But he was upset about the fact that I had not presented the mathematical physical case for it. I didn't quite understand what this meant, but then I found out. On Thursday night, the last event, which was with him, presentation with him before a group of invitees of his project, which is a science project, he had a very abrasive introduction of me and demanding that I do this and demanding that I do that in my presentation and so forth. Then he concluded with the remarks which made it very clear to me. He said, and you can read this in the issue of EIR, which will be published the week after next. I believe that's the issue. We've got his verification that we've got his formulas right, so we can now publish it. He said, in 1975, a group within the Soviet government had undertaken a project of research, a secret project in physical economy, that the son of Suslov, who was there nodding at this point, had protected this group from the Marxist theoreticians, because this would have been considered very heretical work by them. So the name of Suslov had been used to protect this project from the Marxist theoreticians. And they hadn't trusted the theoretical physicists either, so they didn't tell them about it as a group. But they had made a number of discoveries, which you will see in part reflected or referenced in his remarks, which will be published in the EIR a week from next. And he said, we read your book. We found that many of the things we thought were our secrets are reflected in your book. Will you please tell us how you found out about these things? And so some wag in the back in Russian, I fortunately had a translator handy, said, by a good intelligence service. So that was what all the fuss was about, and indicates the great degree of sensitivity in Moscow presently about their relations with the outside world. But my discussions were as follows, and then I'll get back to this point of this final session. First of all, I'll tell you what I emphasized to the Russians to whom I addressed, the particular points. And then I shall indicate what my assessments are of the Russian situation, which are provisional type and are of a strategic nature, which will be of interest to a number of other countries besides people of the U.S. and Russia and Germany and so forth. First of all, I emphasized to them, because I thought it was necessary to clear the air, that we know all about the collapse of the Soviet economy, the East Bloc system, which they knew I had forecast back in 1983. But I said, I have no doubt that the present global financial and monetary system is not only going to collapse, but it's going to go in an absolute breakdown collapse unless, which is very unlikely, unless various governments, including the United States government, were to put the present monetary system into bankruptcy. That would stop the collapse, and nothing else will stop it. What is going to happen, either maybe this spring, maybe this summer, maybe this fall, maybe next year, but it will certainly happen and very soon, is the entire global financial and monetary system, headed up by institutions such as the International Monetary Fund and the Federal Reserve System of the United States. This system is not merely going to collapse, it is going to break apart soon, almost certainly during the term of President William Clinton. Therefore, the only serious question before any of us is not whether the system is going to collapse, it is going to collapse. There's no possibility of saving it. This collapse is unstoppable. The only question is there life after death of the IMF? And therefore, intelligent governments will consider nothing serious except to make preparations for this collapse and to organize quickly a recovery of a new financial system and a new monetary order instant the collapse occurs. That we should do something now, but I don't think governments have the courage to do it politically. But we should prepare for the collapse. The Titanic is sinking. Get the lifeboats ready. And that's the message. So let's not have any talk about how to adapt to the IMF system. I've compared this to try, it's like sticking young eggs under a dead hen. They don't have much of a future. So that, therefore, the question is, what do the United States, Russia, and other countries do in the event of a collapse? We have to put, as states, only governments can do this. So much for free trade. You have to put the system into bankruptcy under law by the action of sovereign nation state governments and by concerted actions among such sovereign nation states. If four or five governments, say, of the world, say, the system is bankrupt, then the system is bankrupt, and there's nothing the system can do about it. It's bankrupt. And that includes putting into bankruptcy the U.S. financial institutions, which means the New York banks, among other things. It means putting them all into bankruptcy reorganization under federal government supervision. By reorganization, that means that we will compel Chase Manhattan and Morgan and so forth to keep their doors open because we are going to use their facilities for recovery even though the banks are bankrupt. So they'll be working for the United States government, not for their former owners. The Federal Reserve System will have to be taken over by the United States government and made into a national bank along the lines indicated years ago by Treasury Secretary Alexander Hamilton. In the case of the United States government will have to create currency under Article 1 of the U.S. Constitution, removing all possibility of the Federal Reserve System issuing currency at its own pleasure by discount mechanisms. We are going to break up the private central banking system of the world and go back to what was called once the American system of political economy as defined by people such as Alexander Hamilton. If we do not do that,
There is no future for the world except chaos. We have no choice. So the job now is to define, first of all, agreement on those measures, and secondly, to define the economic policy measures which will be taken to get the economies moving instantly. We have political responsibilities which have to be met. We have pensions, we have other things. We have where the social crisis would occur if we did not meet these responsibilities. Therefore, the government will order, under bankruptcy reorganization, that these various funds pay their obligations to pensioners and so forth and so on, to maintain social stability. But we've got to get the economy moving. We simply cannot do what, shall we say, the French Jacobin government did at the beginning of the 1790s and start issuing paper as if that's going to solve the problem. The basic need we have in this country and in every country is infrastructure, basic economic infrastructure. We're going to have to build and rebuild railroads. We're going to have to build water systems. We're going to have to build power systems. We're going to have to create these projects as ways of getting the private sector going again, to the same kinds of measures we use for war contracts. That is, if the government sponsors a project, infrastructure project, the private bidders will get a contract if they succeed. These contracts will be discountable at banks for purposes of obtaining credit to meet the payrolls and their purchase of supplies. So we're going to take firms that are bankrupt, we're going to take them off the ground, put them back in business. These kinds of measures. But what we need is a global picture of how to rebuild the world. Because if we do not do this, there's only one alternative. Chaos worse than that which struck Europe during the middle of the 14th century. We see already the world is disintegrating. We see what we saw in Kampuchea under Pol Pot. We see it under Blue Helmet supervision in the Balkans. We see Blue Helmet supervision in Somalia. We see what Blue Helmet supervision meant in Rwanda. We see the efforts to put Blue Helmet operations into operation in every part of the world. Then we have Green Helmets. Now they have the Cairo conference coming up, which is going to tell you how many babies you can have. And they'll have a gamekeeper there to shoot the extra babies the way you shoot extra deer if you try to have too many babies. And that'll be done by the UN, probably under a green helmet or a white helmet. That's what they're heading for. A world imperial dictatorship administering genocidal chaos, which targets, of course, if you happen to have a darker shade of skin, you're likely to get killed more rapidly than otherwise. That's generally the rule, as we see in Africa today. So that was number one. Accept the fact that we have a total collapse. It's impending. We're on the brink of it. Whether it occurs this spring, summer, fall, or next year is irrelevant. We must be prepared. The governments of the world today are not prepared. The leading establishments of the world are not prepared. They're not psychologically prepared. They have not outlawed MIT Economics Department yet, which indicates that they're not prepared, because any decent person would do that. Jeffrey Sachs is not in prison, which indicates they don't have the right attitude about these kinds of things. So we have to be prepared, and we have to be prepared with projects. Now, for the Russians, as I emphasized at the INION presentation, they have experienced the collapse of the Comecon system. They are about to experience the collapse of what they call the capitalist system. Therefore, studies of the Comecon system and the capitalist system, or debates about their merits, are particularly unimportant. It's like debating which of two corpses is less dead. The question is to look at the process of transformation and to learn from a process of change what kind of a change we wish to make. Then I emphasize consistently a number of other things to them in all the presentations. I emphasize that Russia's greatest asset, its only significant economic asset, lies in the science-driven military and aerospace industries. Russia has nothing except these industries. Without these industries and their preservation, the total Russian economy will collapse. not collapse in a financial sense, but collapse in an economic sense. There's not enough food. Not enough is produced. There's not the potential of producing a product by which to earn enough to buy imports. The problem in Russia, of course, was because of the system and because of a sociological problem, which is sometimes called the peasant problem. In Russia, generally, someone went into military service, and if they were bright, they ended up in the military sector as their future career. If they weren't so quick, or they were lazy, or stubbornly not so bright, they got into the civilian economy. The civilian economy was made up of people who did not want to accept technological progress. The tendency was, even among the management, if you had a factory that needed repair, you designed old bricks, and you replaced old bricks, you replaced old machinery. You did not accept new machinery. New machinery was an ideological intrusion into the cultural purity of the local institution. This was the problems the Soviet literature recorded in great detail back in the old days. The problem was that the Russian system did not move technology from where it was being generated in the scientific, military, aerospace sector, did not move it effectively into the rest of the economy. The other problem was, of course, the Russians didn't believe in infrastructure. Stalin always believed that if you build railroad systems, the Germans would use it to overrun the country. Therefore, he had no railroads to deal with. Russian power systems are a disaster. So, and the military side of the thing is very interesting to those of us who studied it, because the military section produced a very capable force, and still does. But it couldn't get that capability into the civilian sector. Also, the military capability of the Soviets was based on adapting to and working around the crudeness of the Russian economy as a whole, which gives you an appreciation of what their science sector is, which is being dissipated. So the science sector of Russia is in that importance. I could also add, which I didn't dwell upon too much publicly there, that to become a scientist in Russia, you probably started as a dissident, a political dissident, before you were caught and shipped off, and you might be shipped off. If you had a political disagreement with your boss, you'd be shipped off as the enemy of the state to some camp someplace for re-education. That's the way you settled bureaucratic problems in those days. But the Russian, like Pobisk himself, who spent about 10 years north of the Arctic Circle in a relevant kind of camp, is that the Russian scientist was often a dissident who, instead of getting into political quarrels with the state, ran off in the military sector, became a scientist, and had an intellectual and moral life as a scientist under the protection of the fact that even though he was an unwanted specimen by communist society, he was nonetheless indispensable to the military aerospace sector. And therefore, a whole section of the Russian scientists is a key part, not only because of their scientific capabilities, but because they represent potentially the core of a very valuable political component of a future Russian society. It is the vital interest of the United States, contrary to Mrs. Thatcher and her puppy dog, Bush, that the Russian military industrial sector be preserved, not demobilized, not torn down, not being turned into pots and pans, because we need it globally. We need to have the Russian economy as a viable proposition. We have a great deal of the world to feed with not enough capacity, and without those kinds of capacities, we will get nowhere. I also emphasize other things in the same direction. Now, my analysis of some of the problems. But first, let me indicate where we fit in, that is, my associates and I fit into this precisely. I've been convinced of this for a long time. I knew this system was not going to be maintained. I knew it back in the 1970s when the floating exchange rate system was put into effect. This system cannot function. And I emphasized to some of the Russians what the problem was. What is the reason, what is the basis on which we know that the system as it now exists has reached past the point of no return of a collapse which is inevitable and total? What we know essentially is that the way the system works is this. You have at the base, you have an economy, a real economy. Physical goods are produced. Certain services like medical services and education and science are produced. These are the essential components of society. But this base is shrinking. And as this base shrinks, the real income base, as measured in physical quantities, plus health care, plus science, plus education, is collapsing. So the standard of living of the typical American is collapsing. The tax revenue base of the United States is collapsing. The collapse is also per square kilometer. The infrastructure of the United States, railroads, water systems, power systems, educational systems, medical systems, science, education, and research are all collapsing per capita and per square kilometer of our territory. Britain today is nothing but a post-industrial mass of rot and garbage. That's what's left of its economy. Under the great leadership of Margaret Thatcher, she's the witch who turned an economy into a garbage pile. And the only thing left flying is a broom. The same process is occurring in Western Europe. Look at the rest of the world. Look at what we've done to Central and South America. We've destroyed it. Look at what we've done to Africa. We've destroyed it. If somebody were to shoot Mandela, all of Southern Africa, south of Sub-Sahara, would go up in blood. That's all it would take. That's how fragile the situation is. And we've got some British and French characters, particularly British, who would like to do that. They're just waiting for him to get in power so they can shoot him, because that's the way to get the maximum degree of destabilization of Southern Africa. So therefore, we see the base contracting, not only on a national basis, but a world basis. We see in the meantime that a financial bubble is increasing. How does it increase? Well, first of all, the financial bubble takes an income stream called profit and interest out of production. It takes an income stream from taxes on households and businesses. That's real. Now this income stream is subject to speculation. A price is put on an income stream called a multiple or leverage, a multiplier, which is gauged against an interest rate. Thus, from the income stream, it now becomes capital, not real capital, but it has a capital price. To buy somebody's rent, the typical real estate speculation, take a landlord's rent and say, how much will you pay for that rent? Now, how do you get that rent? You buy the property. What's the value of the property? The value of its production? No, the value of its rent. If you want to increase the value of the property, you squeeze the tenants or cut the maintenance. Therefore, you increase the rent. Therefore, you multiply the nominal value of the property. Thus, you get a fictitious capital gain. Now you take the fictitious capital gain and you consider that an income stream and you sell that. You issue a stock against that and sell that. You speculate some more and get another income stream, fictitious, and you sell that. Then you date a bunch of idiots who are the children or the grandchildren of John von Neumann. They have a computer and they have game theory. And they have a program that matches the game theory. And they sit down and they program speculation like this. You get a Wendy Graham, the wife, I believe, is what she's called, of Senator Phil Graham. And she legalized derivatives, which would be previously illegal. And they got a vague speculation going on this, and we now have admittedly about $16 trillion is tied up in the average turnover of derivatives. There is an additional, a tremendous secondary market in derivatives, which is totally unregistered, which may take months after the collapse of any bank to find out what it is when you find out who doesn't pay, finally. This is spinning over to total more than $300 trillion a year of turnover of a speculative financial bubble. This speculative financial bubble is all based on the leveraging of a shrinking income stream. So you have a precise analog to terminal cancer, in which the cancer is existing and growing by destroying the body upon which it feeds. And that's what's happening to the world economy, including the economy of the United States. We have now reached the point that in sight, the total income stream from the federal income tax revenue will not be sufficient to pay the debt service on the federal debt? Are you going to, at that point, increase the tax rates? What's the effect of increasing the tax rates under those conditions? Therefore, you have reached a point, a critical point, exemplified by these kinds of facts, which show you that the bubble is about to collapse. And you have a few voices like Marie Soleil writing in Le Figaro periodically warning of the collapse of the big Casino Royale. You have the collapse of the Credit Lyonnais as a result of secondary speculative market in the corruption of the Socialist Party government of France. You have the collapse of a part of Deutsche Bank's enterprise, which is extremely serious. You have the Banesto Bank, which is a Morgan operation in Spain. You have the collapse of the government of Spain as a result of this Banesto operation, which exposed the drug money running of the Felipe González government through people like Cisneros and his La Galería, which is the basis for the Spanish economy at the top. So you have all around the world the symptoms of decay. We have phenomena today. Let's go back to 1931. What was the phenomena that indicated the onset of the Great Depression of the 1930s? The first came in 1931 in the collapse of a bank, the Wiener Kreditanstalt Bank, in the spring of that year, May of that year. The Kreditanstalt Bank, which was tied to British London operations throughout the Balkan Eastern Europe region, out of Vienna, was tied into the same kind of business as the Donat Bank in Germany. So that summer, the Donat Bank collapsed. As a result of that, in September, the Socialist Party of Britain, the Labour Party, let the pound sterling float because they couldn't maintain it any longer. That was the Great Depression, not 1929, that. Today we have, in collapses of banks, like Credit Lyonnais, Banesto, and so forth, in the bailout of Citibank, which was bankrupt, by the Federal Reserve System. The virtual bankruptcy of the Federal Reserve System itself, which is pouring money like mad, printing press money into bailing this out. We have the symptoms of a greater financial collapse than occurred in the 1930s. More devastating. It's all there. People take it for granted. Oh, just another bank went under. So that was clarified. We talked about other problems. Now let me just indicate what I think the answers are, and then come back to what I think the problems in Russia are today. After I'd left Russia, President Boris Yeltsin visited Germany for a meeting with Helmut Kohl, the Chancellor of Germany. At the conclusion of that meeting, there was a public announcement both on the part of Yeltsin and of Kohl. Yeltsin proposed that the German government, which is now to lead the European Union, take over a proposal to build high-speed rails from Berlin to Moscow, and proposed that this be seen as part of a system connecting to Paris, to Moscow, and beyond, through Warsaw. At the same time, in Russia, there was a release which announced the intention to run the rail lines from Moscow to Tokyo, which means to Vladivostok. In the same period that this was announced, we received a communication from the Chinese ministry in response to an EIR inquiry on the Silk Road railroad proposal which is being aired in China. This is published in a currently available edition of Executive Intelligence Review report on this. My view is put this all together and put it together with a program which I proposed in 89, which my wife and others carried forward in the name of the Productive Triangle. We just go back one step in history. World War I was caused by the British and was triggered by a Russian, very simply. That one of the greatest Russians of two centuries, a fellow called a statesman by the name of Count Sergei Vita, negotiated with a protege of Pope Leo XIII, a French politician by the name of Gabriel Anatteau. Gabriel Anatteau was the figure in France backed by Pope Leo XIII against the French revanchists. Witte and Anatteau conceived a proposal which sprang in Witte's case from the work of people such as Mendeleev, the famous chemist and railroad builder, to build a railroad system from Brest to Vladivostok with the included purpose of kicking, with the aid of Japan, kicking the British out of China. As a byproduct of that, the Germans were drawn into a Berlin to Baghdad railroad project. The British, seeing this, were determined to launch World War I, which they did by a series of moves, including inducing a French agent to betray his country by ordering a certain captain to surrender to British forces at Fashoda in Sudan. And Kitchener moved in, accepted the arrangement, and the development of a railroad line, which had been projected by France, from Dakar to Djibouti was canceled. And the British position on Africa was consolidated, except for the French colonies, which were nothing but subdivisions of the British Empire. On the basis of that, an entente cordiale was struck between France and Germany, or France and Britain, into which Russians were drawn through British agents inside the Interior Ministry and other agencies in Russia. Witte was eliminated by the British organizing a revolution in Russia called the 1905 Revolution, using the same forces they used for the Young Turk Rebellion in establishing the Young Turk government in Turkey. As a result of this operation, Russia was drawn into an entente cordiale, is called the Great Entente, the Triple Entente, of that side. A Balkan war, which was used by British-controlled assets, the Serbians, was used, together with British agents inside Russia, in the Bakunin-Pranslav tradition, to engage Russia in a passion over defense of the Serbs, who were British agents. They played upon the stupidity of the Austrian government and engaged a potential war in that region. The French and British then connived with Moscow, while Germany was conniving with Moscow. Germany was conniving to try to prevent a war, and the British and French were working to have one. Germany had an agreement with Vienna to defend Vienna if it was placed under attack from Russia. So that's how the war began, with the Balkan War orchestrated by the British, the same way Margaret Thatcher got this Balkan War going this time now. The purpose of that was to destroy the possibility that Eurasia, Northern Eurasia, would collaborate in economic development. The idea of moving a railroad system at the beginning of this century, moving a railroad system from Brest to Vladivostok, and running southward running lines off the main axis meant the economic development of all of Eurasia. That was killed by World War I, and the British took means to set up a perpetual conflict within Eurasia to prevent this from happening again. The Versailles Treaty set up a League of Nations, which for various reasons the United States rejected for sound reasons, because some people in the United States resisted surrendering our sovereignty to a League of Nations. It didn't fly. Time came, 1932. A new government came to power in Germany, the von Schleicher government. The von Schleicher government was suspected by the British of being ready to deal with parts of Russia for economic cooperation to develop trade and recovery for both. Therefore, the British and the Americans, including Harriman and George Bush's daddy, Prescott Bush, moved the money from the German banks controlled by Harriman and company into the Nazi Party coffers on behalf of the British. in order to bring the British protege, Adolf Hitler, to power. The purpose of bringing Hitler to power, which was done with the aid of the German Social Democrats, who brought down the von Schleicher government, was to ensure, number one, there would be no cooperation on continental Europe, and that World War II would ensue by virtue of an assured war between Germany and Russia, which Hitler's chancellorship would have meant. So we've had two world wars as a result of the British not liking the idea of Eurasian development based on railroad centers and based on kicking the British out of China. Now, the British have made themselves persona non grata in China. The British have been spreading all over Tokyo a Japanese language report through Chatham House, that's the institution that owns Henry Kissinger, stating that British policy is to have a war in China on the death of Deng, in which the provincial interests, which are being influenced by the British through these investment zones, will come into a military conflict with the central authority, and a civil war will break out, which is what the British want. This has not pleased the Chinese very much, who are very unhappy with this Patton, who is the governor of British governor of Hong Kong, which is what the whole quarrel's about. So you have that situation. My view is this. If we look ahead to the future of humanity and look beyond the sinking of the Titanic, we have an obvious way of reorganizing the world, which is the alternative to going to death or hell under a UNO world dictatorship. And that is to do what the British have always feared, do the geopolitical utmost. Let us foster rails from Brest to Vladivostok. Let us foster the development of the Silk Road Railroad in China. Let us foster collaboration among two sections of Asia. One, define the northern section of Eurasia from the Atlantic to Vladivostok. Then devise the southern part of Asia, which is China, the Asian Rim, and South Asia. Now integrate the two in the logical way in which they should be integrated, which means that you are now in the area of the world's majority of its population. This now includes the basins of the Indian and Pacific Oceans. The basin includes the east coast of Africa. The basin includes the west coast of the Americas. This is where the world's future population will be concentrated. If we're developing physical economy, these are the trade routes. So therefore, Europe, the center of the engine of high technology production, move that eastward and southward through rail links using maglev and high-speed rail, not old types of rail, for economy. Involve countries in cooperation with their reduced circumstances to build up this system of infrastructure. Use this infrastructure building to spin off the other industries which are needed, because you need the infrastructure for the industry, and the building of the infrastructure is the initiative, the catalyst for developing the industry. We should commit ourselves to such a policy, to such cooperation among sovereign nation states, and let the imperialists who drown this world in war for a century, let them go hang. Like at Margaret Thatcher, take her broom and fly to the moon or Mercury or the asteroid belt, which you'd probably be much happier. Let her take George Bush as our pet cat on the rumble seat of the broom. And let us proceed to do that which has been forbidden, which is in the vital interest of our country, to foster this kind of development in Eurasia and in South Asia, and to use cooperation with that as the way to rebuild the world economy. Since we're losing the garbage pail, do that. Now, the alternative is this. In Russia today, there are three alternatives, generally. The three alternatives involve five components of the population categorically. One component is the Russian people generally. A second component is the military security forces. A third component is the military industry as such. Another is the gangster element, which is very important. and a fourth is the intelligentsia, which are tied to science. If the people go to the, and also the Russian Orthodox Church is part of this picture, if the people in desperation and fear go to the military security forces, as they are doing, and if there is no other element of the situation, a continuation of the present process will lead either A, to a military security forces-backed dictatorship, not necessarily military dictatorship. A military dictatorship is not in the Russian cultural character, but a dictatorship backed by the military and security forces is. The alternative to that is chaos. We already have war in Transcaucasus. We have potential war breaking out around Kazakhstan. We have the potentiality of destabilization which could lead to other kinds of wars in the region, which involve nuclear and other weapons. Chaos spreading throughout the planet. That is less probable, I think, than dictatorship, but it's highly probable. The third alternative is something along the lines I've indicated. Those are the three alternatives. I see no other. The idea that there's going to be some great rise of a democratic movement around capitalism and free trade and whatnot to rebuild Russia is a complete pipe dream. The last chance for a democratic solution in Russia went out the windows when the windows were shot out at point blank range by Russian tank artillery. I stood there in front of the Ukrainian hotel on that little spur of road beside the bridge. And I looked right across at the building, which had been painted up since to get the defacing removed. And I saw exactly where the tanks, it was indicated where the tanks had been lined up and how the fire had been directed against there. The reason the fire was there rather from another position was because the press was there to witness it. They had an office there, could watch it. When that artillery barrage destroyed the parliament, the last chance of a democratic solution in the foreseeable future in Russia went out the broken window. The Russian reform movement has become increasingly visibly demoralized since that time, increasingly so. The new parliament, the Duma, has no perception of power. There's no likelihood under present circumstances that it will assume power. Therefore, forget it. The Russian people are not asking for permission to devise democratic solutions. The Russian people are like a drowning man, saying, look, don't give me that crap about trying to swim, rescue me. And when the Russian people, who are Russian people, scream to the military and security forces, rescue us, you are likely to get things in the direction which are now being reflected by General Ruskoy. That doesn't mean Ruskoy is a factor who's the author of this. This means it's an organic tendency which is highly visible in Russia. Therefore, if the United States were to continue with Europe its present policy toward Russia, we are going to get either chaos or we are going to get a dictatorship, which will be filled with hate toward the United States. On top of that, I can tell you, from my observations on the scene in Russia, which means, given my limited observations, it has to be taken very seriously. British agents are operating in Moscow to accelerate conflicts between Washington and Moscow, and doing everything possible to have the United States blamed emotionally for every problem that the people of Russia are suffering. And they are suffering. Not as badly as Eastern Europe, not as badly as elsewhere. I'm not in a position to judge that personally by eyesight, but experts have told me the situation, and that's the picture. And what they describe is less bad than is the situation in Eastern Europe. That's our situation. My function in this picture, as I see it, is that Russians have drawn me in to a position of an academician in the Russian system, particularly on the basis of economic science, but also on other things. I was invited for 4 days to Moscow to meet with various parts of the Ministry of Economics and the Academy of Sciences, which is, in a sense, a home base for me at this point, in part. We had extremely serious discussions, including a discussion of the principles of physical economy with Bobysk Kuznetsov on the Thursday evening of the final day I was there. Obviously, I have responsibilities which flow from this. My answer to those responsibilities is manifold, but in this particular case, it's what I've indicated to you here. The United States has no policy. Under Bush, we had a policy which was New World Disorder, Thatcher's policy. The present presidency may have directions, but it has no policy. The United States has no policy. Well, that's not particularly embarrassing because Britain has no policy except bad things, and no other government in the world has policy. Thus, we have to have a policy, and my job, I believe it, is to articulate a policy. I believe the only visible policy is, first of all, accept the fact that the system is going to collapse, accept the evidence as to why it's going to collapse, be prepared to build a new system. Now, the Titanic is sinking, build lifeboats. Economically, in other words. But we must have a global strategic perspective. We cannot pull into ourselves and sit in America and watch the world go to hell and wait to see what happens afterward until the smoke clears. We have to have a global strategic perspective. I propose the global strategic perspective is the obvious one. Yeltsin has proposed, which I think is more than a Yeltsin proposal, it's a Russian proposal, has proposed that Chancellor Kohl take the lead in catalyzing railroad building as a way of approaching the situation. I concur it should be done. China has proposed and has given us additional information on the Silk Road. They wish to build it. They've indicated reasons for building. They've indicated a perspective. We should propose that. We should endorse it. We should endorse the idea of Eurasian cooperation, using Central Europe as a generator of technology to help catalyze the development of the rest of the region. We should propose with Japan a South Asia policy from China, Southeast Asia, South Asia. We should draw representatives of this region of the world into cooperation, both through private means and other, in order to encourage a discussion out of which a policy and a policy consensus may arise, or at least the basis for policy consensus. The United States government needs that. The Russians need it. If we introduce something in which the Russian people and the Russian leaders, the intelligentsia, can recognize that what is being proposed is in the vital interests of their nation, I think, as in other cases, they will find that they can translate that into results. I think that without such a policy, the world is plainly going to hell. Thank you.
Yes.
May I ask approximately what do you think such a railroad building project would cost, and who do you think would finance it?
We're talking about, what, $3-5 million a kilometer or something? About what these things cost these days. So what? Now, the cost, it has to be measured, I think, in different terms than we normally think. What we have to think of is a reconstruction program. And speaking to the Russians, I, particularly at INION, I mentioned I said, look, I'm born in 1922. What happened to Russian men during World War II who were born in 1922? Where are they? What happened after the war in Russia, in Poland, and Germany? Old people with their bare, bleeding hands picked up rubble, knocked the mortar off it, and used it to begin rebuilding buildings. We are going into a rebuilding phase. We have to accept that. We have to evoke not merely the economics of rebuilding, because there were no economics. The spirit of rebuilding was the basis for economics. We have to do the same thing again. What we need, therefore, is to generate a credit system and a selection of the use of that credit for projects. The point, therefore, is if I build a rail system, I'm building a tax revenue base, even in the construction process itself. Therefore, I have to manage the process through banking, the way Hamilton described it, so that, yes, it's going to cost a great deal. What am I going to use? I'm going to use labor that otherwise is idle. I'm going to use factories that are shut down, that maybe are imperfect, but I don't care. We'll get the product, we'll get the job done. So this thing will cost us nothing. The example I use is with reference to our experience with the Kennedy moon manned landing program, in which the estimate was in Washington that we got 14 cents back into the economy for every penny in the program because of the technological spillovers and the new industries in the economy. So what we have to do is have a managed approach. What I mentioned in Russia as the reference point is go back to the Ecole Polytechnique under Monge between 1794 and 1814 as an example of how these things are done. A science driver program of reconstruction, which is the kind of thing you do after a disaster. I think at this point, if we could get the thing started, don't worry about it. We could get something going under present financing basis, which is $3-5 million, or say a mile or kilometer, somewhere in between there. Do it. We don't care what it costs, because we have to get the thing started as a policy measure. In the long run, the cost of the thing. Look, Russia has one of the lowest population densities of any nation in the world. Part of that's desert land, part of that's Arctic land. But you cannot run a modern economy on low population density without a very economic and efficient rail system. You can use, for bulk freight, you can use an inland water system. Air transport is not an efficient system for an economy, only for very critical, high cost items and special bottleneck items. So the thing you have to rely upon in an internal landlocked economy to make it efficient is you must have a modern, efficient transport system whose efficiency you measure in ton, mile, hours, dollars. And you want maximum utilization of that. When you build the rail line, it's like building a canal. You're building development. You're turning useless land into valuable, productive land. You're creating industries. You're creating agriculture. And from the tax revenue base of this kind of benefit, you pay for it. So our problem is to consider what is the relationship between the benefit and the expenditure, and can we balance the two off? And can we make it as a pay-as-you-go proposition? Yes, with an initial capital to get it started, it becomes a pay-as-you-go proposition. It's like what I proposed the SDI. I thought I proposed the SDI back in 1982, about December, I estimated what it would cost to do a Mark I SDI level would be about $200 billion. My estimate was from that point on, which would take about 5 years. On a five-year $200 billion level, I figured that at the end of 5 years, the spin-off effects for the U.S. economy would be such that actually we would be getting more back for every dollar in the SDI than we would be paying for it. And that would be self-financing. So these projects in general, in history, have a characteristic. You have a startup capital of a process which through labor is turned into a generator of new revenue. The new revenue will then keep the thing going, and that's my view of it. Yeah, it costs maybe $3-5 million a mile. So what? I don't care. Get it started, not with the idea that this is going to pay off in ticket revenue. It's going to pay off in the benefits to the economy.
Yes.
Respect to your prediction of when the economy, the world economy, collapses and literally breaks apart. When this occurs, you're suggesting that the Federal Reserve will absolutely break apart. When that happens, will the United States be in a position to return to a stronger nationalistic nation, or will we be at a weaker point?
Let me put it, it depends on what's done. I don't think it's spontaneous. I think it depends on what we've done. Let's imagine this, you have the announcement. Now, the first thing you say, okay, what do you want to happen? You've got Clinton as president. Your concern is that on that particular day or in that vicinity, he gets on the horn and says, we're going to do the following. And he says, I have used the following emergency powers as president, and I've asked the Congress and so such a person of the Congress to come up here, and we're going to work this out from the Congress side. You want him to do that. That's all that's required technically on paper to straighten the situation out. So you want a president who does that. Now, the problem today is there's no preparation for him to do that, in his mind, perhaps, or elsewhere. What we have is Gonzales in the Gonzales Committee. He's been leaking a few things. we have a rather empty discussion, but a useful one, about Hamiltonian economic alternatives. You can pick up from various publications here and there, talk about a turn to Hamiltonian alternatives. You read these things, they're very shallow. But the fact is somebody's talking about an alternative. So you have to put some meat into that discussion, a solid discussion. We need to have an emergency preparation. Now, if you have preparation, and if you have around the country not a president standing up with his bare face hanging out saying, let's do this, but instead you have people in every part of the country who know what he's talking about, including people in influential positions, people who are in part of the pores of political organization, then it functions. So you say, we want patriots, we're going to take over the Federal Reserve System tomorrow morning, or I just did it under the emergency powers which the Democrats gave me back in 1970s as president. They didn't know I was going to be president, but they created these powers under these Emergency Powers Acts for financial crisis. I'm going to use the acts. I've just used it. I've declared a national emergency on the basis of a financial crash, and I've just taken over the Federal Reserve System. Now, that, apart from cheering a certain quarters, and also some pain. The question is, who's going to implement it? What does that mean? If I were to say it today, most people wouldn't know what it means. If he says it, they wouldn't be sure what he meant at all. So the problem is we have a process, we have very limited time. And the important thing is to get this message out. The thing that's blocking us is that people say, well, the system's going to collapse. And the same thing as in Russia. The system's going to collapse. You become obsessed. Can't we save it some way? Because you have the idea there is no alternative. Now, the first thing you've got to get people out of people's minds is the idea that this can be saved. It can't be saved. So the first thing people have to recognize is why it can't be saved. You can't just say, well, on my authority, I think it can't be saved. Say, no, look, sit down, understand why this is past the point of no return, the system is going to collapse, and soon. Now, once people reconcile, the passengers on the Titanic will actually reconcile themselves to the thing that this is not an unsinkable ship, that it can sink. Right? The management of the company is crazy. They're getting the captain to do something perfectly silly. They're taken in by their own propaganda. The ship is about to sink. Let's do something. Then they say, okay, no longer do they debate whether it's going to sink. They say, what do we do? And I would rather have the American people and others in that situation, or the Russians too. What are we going to do? Fine. Let's discuss what we're going to do. So therefore, I think the greatest problem we have today is the delusion coming from so-called economists who say, well, the system is not going to collapse. Yeah, you're right, there are many problems with the system, but it's really not going to collapse. It is going to collapse. And that is the educational point that has to be addressed, I think, first. Because once people accept the fact that the collapse is inevitable, then they will open their minds to considering alternatives. And there are alternatives. But you have to have the idea of the alternative established in at least some minds before the crisis occurs. Otherwise, you'll have someone saying, here's what we should do. And then 5,000 years from now, some historian will say, this guy said the right thing, but nobody was willing to act. It's like commanding troops. Two things that a commander-in-chief has to know in time of a crisis. First of all, he has to have some people who can command troops for him. And secondly, he has to tell them that if they don't get the troops on the other side of the river tonight, at nightfall, before morning, he's going to fire them, the way Lazare Carnot did. And that's how you get out of a crisis, in my view. But we do not have at this moment some of the essential ingredients required. First is clarity among a large number of people that this is the situation, in which case they're going to be open to saying, well, what do I do? What's my role? Secondly, you have to have a large number of people in the country who are willing to, who understand what has to be done, who are willing to organize support for its being done and making it work. Those are the two ingredients we must supply in the time available.
Yes.
I want to have asked, I have posed this question some time before. But I want to know what is the effect of the inner party or in a struggle for power in Russia on world peace. I'm saying this because some people believe that the inner party struggle in Russia between Stalin and Trotsky led to help his, Hitler to declare world war, the Second World War. Because, of course, as a result of this struggle between the two, a pogrom took place. Stalin got rid of the cream of the army. This is the stimulated appetite of Hitler to do it. This is not my own point of view, but I read that in an old book by Louis Fisher.
Oh, yeah.
Politics, Men and Politics, an old book. He said that, and also I read for something in the same way by Strachey, John Strachey, the liberator who made the road to socialism. This will lead me to another question, if you allow, sir. By the way, I'm very much impressed by what I've been saying. I've been following you for a long time. Honestly, this is a fact. I was an ambassador in Russia one day. Then I'm now here ambassador in Washington. But I've been following God, reading everything you write. I'm highly impressed, I'm sure. My question is, what do you think, what will happen to Trotskyism? Because what happened in Russia, I believe, is a defeat. One version of Marxism, of Leninist values, which is not for the, in the same time, it vindicated Trotsky, his revolution for the permanent revolution. Of course, he was against the revolution in a single country, and he predicted the collapse of it, and it collapsed. Maybe here in Europe, or in America, or in Europe, you don't feel that. I'm coming from Africa. In our country, the intellectuals, who are, of course, being disappointed for the failure of the Leninist version. Maybe they go to the Trotsky. Which, because, especially that, abundance of literature written by Trotsky, who lived up to 1940, Lenin passed away in 24, and he covered a lot, many areas. And the people are disappointed of what is happening in Europe and in America. Not for this parliamentary democracy. They have already lost faith in lost the Soviet democracy. They need something like, anti-racial democracy, which they don't find. What do you think of that, sir?
Well, this what you're describing, I think, is largely confined to Africa. There may be a few other cases in third world countries. If you go back to what happened in Africa in the post-war period, particularly with the beginning of the winds of change of Macmillan, is that very special operations run there. And these countries very soon found themselves running to Moscow, hoping, particularly from the time of the Lumumba affair, running to Moscow, hoping that there was somehow there an alternative to what they were getting from the West, that the first development decade was proving to be a rather strong disappointment for Africa. And thus, you had in Africa a different attitude on these questions than you had in Western Europe or even in parts of Asia. Or most of Asia or in the Western Hemisphere. A completely different situation. So I think the question you're asking could only arise from that standpoint. To take, for example, the history of the Russian Revolution is very simple. The Russian Revolution was organized entirely by movements which were created by British intelligence. Trotsky was originally an agent of British intelligence. He was funded by Warburg. He came out of Odessa. And while he was in Vienna, in exile, he was taken over by the Warburg interest who funded him. He came to the United States as a Warburg protege when he finally got out, which is very significant. Now, but the history is interesting. Also from Odessa, the most famous agent in the 20th century is a fellow called Alexander Helfen, called Pavas. Pavas went from Odessa, he went to London, he was a British agent, he was recruited by the Fabian Society, they took him to meet Engels, who was still alive. He went down into Germany, where he is assigned by British intelligence to be a leader of the left wing of the German social democracy in Leipzig and elsewhere. He was working closely with Radek. He then turns up controlling Trotsky in St. Petersburg in 1905. He wrote Permanent Revolution, which is Trotsky's doctrine. Helfand did it. And then he turned up back in Germany. And very soon he was kicked out of Germany in a scandal because he and his buddy, a scoundrel by the name of Karl Radek, were caught embezzling money. So at that point, Helfand Pavas left Germany and turned up in Turkey. In Turkey, Helfand Pavas was backed by International B'nai B'rith, the same International B'nai B'rith Lodge, British-controlled, which created and was the Young Turk government of 1908. That's the government that used the Kurds to kill the Armenians. It was done by B'nai B'rith. In fact, in the B'nai B'rith area were Reconati, the big family, the Aleppo grain trading family with Odessa. Also, Pavas was an agent, a grain trader with Reconati, how he made his money. He was also a weapons agent for Vickers, British Vickers. He was involved heavily in the Balkan Wars, the first Balkan War, and the second, in funding it. In 1916, he was picked up through Turkey by British intelligence and sold to the German military intelligence service for the sum of 1 million gold Reichsmarks for what was called the Pavas Plan. At that time, the British were supporting the Mensheviks around Kerensky for overthrowing the Tsar. The Tsar was their wartime ally, and they were overthrowing him. The Germans, therefore, were sold by the British on the idea of supporting Lenin as the alternative. So the Germans paid, according to Bernstein, who was a German intelligence official at that time, 30 million Reichsmarks to Pavas for his own services, plus what Pavas stole, and he could steal abundantly, for this operation. Pavas then got Lenin through Radek to take this trip to go back to Moscow. He put 5 million gold Reichsmarks in Karl Radek's pocket. They went back to Russia. It worked out that the Mensheviks lost, the British number one group lost, and the number two group, the fallback group, the Bolsheviks, won. At that time, the Bolsheviks with Lenin, but particularly Trotsky and Dzerzhinsky, set up what became known as the Cheka. The Cheka was set up by British intelligence through Captain Hill. Right? So that what we are given as politics from Russian communist politics is fraud. Yes, things happen, but Stalin was a peculiar animal. Stalin was a third roamer. And when the whole crowd that was the international crowd, the communist international crowd, which included Trotsky, Bukharin, and so forth, they divided. So we have today, you have two groups. You have the fascist left, which is called the neocons in the United States. They run the Washington Times, the American Spectator, Commentary Magazine, the Wall Street Journal, and so forth. These are our local fascists. These are formerly Bukharinites, or Trotskyists, all of them. J. Lovestone's crowd. J. Lovestone was a British agent who became head of the Communist Party on the appointment of Bukharin in the 1920s. Bukharin himself was a British agent. From 1932 to 1938, to my knowledge, Lovestone was a joint Soviet British U.S. State Department agent, but always controlled by the British. Leo Chern was a Soviet agent, together with Lovestone, with the American Rescue Committee, which was a British intelligence operation set up jointly with the Soviets. These guys have now gone from being the leftists of the so-called right opposition to becoming the neocons of today. They are all, the Jewish part traces their ancestry spiritually from Vladimir Jabotinsky, who was the editor of Young Turk magazine for the Young Turk government, who was taken by Volpi di Misurata and brought into Italy to become a fascist. He was a Mussolini-controlled fascist during the 1930s and World War II. This is called the Likud faction in Israel, which is now calls itself the young neocon section of the Jewish community in the United States. Right? So with them is who they got. Irving Kristol, the so-called Trotskyist, who is also a neocon. So from these people, there is no hope to be expected. What happens in reality is that human beings exist, history exists. When Most, I could demonstrate from my knowledge that most of the movements and figures in modern history for the past 300 years have been fake. Not only the heroes, but everybody else. I don't even think the British Empire is British. I mean, everything is a fake. But there is a certain element of reality which does not occur in the form of the sincerity or arguments of the players. The reality occurs in the impact of two things: the real forces of history acting upon the players, and then the fact that man is in the image of God. And therefore the individual responds at some level to that fact, despite British human nature, or we call it dehumanized nature, Lockean dehumanized nature. So the actual aspirations of the individual as a creature in the image of God reflect themselves, despite what the individual says they believe otherwise. History, reality, reflects itself. You can never live in virtual reality. You have to accept reality. The guy has to take off the headset to eat once in a while. And he may even have to go out and earn the money to get his food. So virtual reality is not a place that people can live. They can only fantasize. And thus, in all these movements, there are elements which are real because reality has reflected itself. Many things Trotsky said about this or that were right. Many things said about him were right. But that's because of the interplay of reality. You put a bunch of actors on stage, in most of history, I'm convinced, is living theater, which somebody's controlling a bunch of jokers, putting them on stage, and getting them to play a part according to what they're cranked up to do. And then they sit back and laugh and applaud at the performance. But I think today the hope for Africa and other parts of the world lies not in these fantasies, but precisely the opposite direction. I think one of my jobs and the job of others like me is to expose the fraud, which is called written and official history, and to show people that real history is the history of ideas, ideas which correspond to the struggle to bring into being a form of society which corresponds to the fact that man is created in the image of God, as God the Creator, by virtue of the fact that we as human beings can do what no animal species can do. We can choose to increase our productive potential, our population density, to change ourselves and our nature, to improve ourselves, to improve our society. No animal can do that. We can conquer the universe eventually. It's given to us. It's our dominion assigned to us. We will conquer the universe by aid of reason. What our job is to recognize some things we should have learned along the road and to say, what do we have to do to create a society which is fit for man in the image of God? What do we do to create a form of society which the individual is educated according to his or her potential, as in the image of God? A form of society in which the individual is employed in a manner which corresponds to such a person, such a being. An individual who is given the opportunity to assimilate the knowledge of the past and to transmit it enhanced to the people of the future. I use in an article in this which is in Fidelio, the image of the famous painting of the mural which is in the Vatican apartments in Rome, in the old Vatican apartments of Julius II, the so-called famous school of Athens. One has to actually stand there and see it in its actual setting to get the full impact of what Raphael did with that mural. But in it you find a collection of people, including the face of Raphael himself, which is represents people from different times, all walking and conversing on some subject in the hall. And Plato and Aristotle are walking in, Plato pointing up and Aristotle pointing down to his genitals or something, right? Usual kind of thing. And there's a discussion, but who are the people? Now, I know this experience. I know exactly what happens in Raphael's mind as I describe it in that article. That if we're properly educated, and this becomes most apparent in the sciences, we study, for example, to recreate the Pythagorean theorem. Well, that's about 600 BC or something like that, in Magna Graecia. Then we go on to the work of Plato, Theaetetus, and Doxus, and so forth, in the time of Plato. And we study, we recreate in our own mind the mental experience of a discovery made by each of these persons. Similarly, if you want to become a scientist, you learn this throughout history. These discoveries, you can't simply learn them, you have to re-experience them, as if you were the discovery re-experiencing what passed through his mind. And thus, that portion of the mind of each of these people lives inside your mind for the rest of your life, the creative experiences. And therefore, we have a relationship to one another where Plato is more alive for me in that sense than George Bush. George Bush is a phantasm of some LSD nightmare, whereas Plato is real, because I have re-experienced a thought that, or more than one thought that passed through Plato's mind. Pythagoras, Riemann, Kusa, Leonardo da Vinci. These are the people who exist in my mind. So they existed for Raphael. A mural of the people who live still as living people in the creative process of his mind are all in his head. And when Raphael or I or somebody else like that wants to make a decision, we consult the people in our head who are the active part of our conscience. These are our intellectual parents. They therefore live with us today. So what's our relationship with them? Distance, time, no. We touch them and they touch us directly. They touch us by what they give to us in a living way. We touch them by bringing to reality, realization, what they have given. We make their contribution immortal. To live is to teach a child that, to educate a child's soul. So the child can die as an old man having become immortal. Now, the job we have is to create a society, is to get that image across to statesmen and to base policy on shaping society so we produce that result. And anything else, from my knowledge of history, which is sometimes called living theater, where people pull the strings above stage, let's get to reality. Man, the reality of man's nature is we are in the image of God, and we can prove it, because no other species can be creative. The relationship of man to man, even across thousands of years, separation, is something which no animal could have. Our relationship to the past shows us our relationship to the future. We can live happily knowing we are that. Our job as statesmen is to ensure that every child has that opportunity and that we create a form of nation state which guarantees to every child that right and perpetuates society on that basis. That to me is the only reality. And everything else is some kind of living theater illusion. Go ahead.
Sir, may I ask that you explain just why the financial structure of the world is going to collapse? I need to think about that.
First of all, you find some of it in here, just a reference, and that's why I got the glossary along here, that in describing these inequalities, the primary inequality, that you say, what do we produce? Forget money. Think about physically, what are we producing? Because money is only a means of exchange. All credit is a means of exchange. So let's look at what the means of exchange is supposed to be administering. So look at the physical aspects. What are the aspects? You have physical consumption of industry and person and households necessary to maintain. And as Leibniz pointed out, when you have a higher standard of living, you require to have a higher productivity. All right. Now, in addition to enable society to produce, we also need education, science, and we need health care. If you need a scientist and he takes 30 years before he can finish and become a qualified scientist, you don't want him dying at the age of 35. So therefore, you've got to have health care to have technology. If you have a poor society with low life expectancy, people have to quit work at 12 or 13 or 15. How can you have development? Or Africa, people live to 40 as a mean expectation or 50 as a mean expectation. How can you have a modern society? They don't have a chance. They don't live long enough to have a chance. So these ingredients. All right, now take any instant in the process of an economic process. Let's talk, call this consumption of material things plus education plus science plus healthcare, let's call that energy of the system, is what's required to keep the production process going. Now let's look at what, let's take those same kinds of things and let's see how much we're producing at that instant. Now let's look at the ratio between those two things as your first parameter. Ratio of production to the rate of consumption. That gives you what's called a free energy ratio. But you observe something else. You observe that the energy density in the form of infrastructure, capital intensity, so forth, the complexity of the division of labor increases as you get to higher levels of productivity. So there you have this twofold ratio, which is not entropic, which doesn't fit the so-called laws of thermodynamics, as no living process does for it, by the way. Right. Now, that's real. The income is, the net income is the increase of output over input. Now, so therefore, as long as you invest the output in perpetuating the input process and have a process of growth, fine, you're fine. Now, what happens if instead of investing that output, you take that output, not only the profitable part, but some more, and you take it away from the productive process? You're shrinking the productive process. You invest that now in paper. You go to a casino on the corner, and you gamble away not just the profits on your production, you gamble away part of the capital. Say you run a firm. So you take not only the profits, you gamble those away at the casino, but you also take some of the petty cash and something else and so forth, sell one of the company cars, and you gamble that away. I've seen that in the old days I was doing consulting. I saw some firms go down that way. Which is good lesson in economics. So you see, now, how does that happen to an economy? All right, let's take RJR Nabisco. It's a gigantic swindle, which should not be allowed. You put people in jail for trying to do that in a rail-run economy. You loot the economy. What do? You walk up and say, I'm going to buy your company. How much? Well, I don't want to sell. We're going to pay you a lot. Where's the money? Oh, we're going to get it from selling your assets once you buy your company. Junk bonds. So this kind of process has gone on. Now, they rig the economy such that the rate of return and cash on speculation is greater than the rate of return on investment in business. Or people take the money out of the business, and what happens then, you have a financial management. Now, the biggest thief in any country is the treasurer or the financial management. Oh, sure, he's the guy that does the stealing. He tells you that your responsibility to the stockholders is to steal from your company to put it into speculation, to invest it in money management, financial management. So now you take your assets, you liquidate your company, you sell this off, you fire the employees, you do this in order to invest in this business. Now you say the multiplier effect, the so-called leverage. Suppose they say the average rate of return in this economy competitively is 15 to 1. You expect $1 for every 15 bucks you put in. Therefore, to buy $1 return competitively, you pay 15 bucks. Say, I got a dollar. Revenue. You got a dollar per year revenue. What am I offering? The guy says 15 bucks for it. So now I sell a dollar for 15 bucks. A dollar a year, 15 bucks. The right to take the dollar a year. Now, somebody comes along and says, well, that dollar's now worth 16. So now I have $1 profit plus $1 in gain of something that never existed. Because the $15 never existed. That is, you never had $15 to sell. You had $1. So they buy it for you on the basis of a leverage base for $15. Now you, having bought it for the $15, now have a $1 a year yield. But you know it's been going up. And so you now you find it's going up to $16 yield. 16 time yield. So now you have $16 asset instead of $15. So you have the $1 a year yield, and now you've got a dollar capital gain you've added to it. Now that is now an income stream which is now priced on a basis of 16 times that. Now, how do you keep this going? In order to keep this going, you've got to keep that process going. Otherwise, your value will collapse by a factor of 15 or 16 downward. So you've got to go back to the base and steal some more money to keep the process going. What you have to do is you take over a company, you sell off its assets, part of its productive capacity, its real estate, its this, its that. You loot the employees, fire the key employees, cut out research, cut out replacement, don't pay your amortization, don't pay for to repair, maintenance, so forth, like they do with railroads. Now you put that into the gambling casino of this 15 or 16 time operation. And what you're doing is they're building up this mass which requires more and more looted out of the economy to take it. And you're shrinking at the same time you're shrinking the productive base. So all you do is take the figures on the total, take the total population, what percentage of the population is in manufacturing actually, what percentage is in other productive categories, what happened to them? What's the tax revenue base today in deflated terms as opposed to 5 years ago, 10 years ago, 20 years ago? And you see the tax revenue base is shrinking, the bubble is expanding. The bubble could be sustained only by an increasing tax revenue base, but the tax revenue base is shrinking. Then you have the Federal Reserve, which goes in and prints money on discounting to keep this process going. It's that simple. That's the general formula, is that you have two components. You have real capital, which represents the investment in actual production or related things. Then you have fictitious capital, which is the spending of real money for something which is given capital value but which has no value. Then you accept fictitious value as having the same value as money which comes out of production. And that's where we are. Now you've got a debt. The Federal Reserve subsidizes these guys. They do it by selling government bonds. Therefore, they manipulate the process to increase the federal debt, and the whole thing is guaranteed by Woodrow Wilson's income tax law, which guarantees that you, the taxpayer, will pay an income tax to fund the federal debt, which is how the Federal Reserve System was set up in the first place. We've come to the end of that through the introduction, the breakdown of the gold reserve system, and the introduction of the floating exchange rate system, then the Fulcrum measures, then deregulation, 1978, 1982.
Any other questions? Okay. Thank you all very much.